I'm Joe Reamer. I'm a professor at Brandeis. I've been with the Genesis program since its inception. And I also direct something called the Institute for Informal Jewish Education. Havdalah is the ceremony that caps the end of the Sabbath. It means in Hebrew to separate. It separates the Sabbath from the rest of the week. At Genesis, it's a truly joyous occasion. The end of the Sabbath marks an explosion of energy. You haven't lit a candle. You haven't turned on a light, perhaps, for the last 25 hours. Now you do. It's a moment of special intensity for kids in a program like Genesis. Havdalah allows you to release that energy, especially if you're young, into the night.
Genesis is a summer program for high school students that integrates the arts, humanities, Jewish studies, and social action in a way that really tries to bring teens from all different backgrounds, perspectives, geographies, socioeconomic environments, traditions, experiences with Judaism together to form a community of learning and appreciation of diversity and others, and in a way that will also intellectually challenge them using the resources of the university and the wonderful educators that we have here at the program.
We came to Genesis looking for a setting in which we could see the best of informal Jewish education at work. We wanted to know, how do informal Jewish educators do what they do? What distinguishes Genesis from most Jewish summer experiences is that it's a mix of a summer school, the kids take courses in the morning, and a summer camp. They have very rich informal Jewish experiences all afternoon, evening, and weekend long.
Certainly this is nothing formally stated in Genesis, but I think it serves as sort of a buffet table. On staff we have a wide range of different ideologies, and we offer it all for anybody who would choose to participate. And I think that's pretty comfortable, even for kids who don't know a great deal. Maybe especially for kids who don't know a great deal.
The community informal educators work both on one-on-one level, small group level, and with the students as a whole body. 70, 75 students at once requires a very different kind of skill of facilitation, of mobilizing, of empowering, than it will do within smaller groups.
Max is the head CIE at Genesis. He's returning from last summer. He's a doctoral student at the Harvard Graduate School of Education. After spending 2 years in Israel, Max is perhaps the most secular of all the CIEs at Genesis. After working for 6 years with college students, Dana is coming for the first time to work with high school students in Genesis. A graduate of the University of Arizona, Dana is now a rabbinical student at the Jewish Theological Seminary in New York. Scott grew up in the Reform Movement. He's worked with teens, both in the Jewish context and in secular contexts. He's currently a rabbinical student at the University of Judaism in Los Angeles. Farah is an alumna of Brandeis University. After graduating, she worked for 15 months with Jewish youth in Savannah, Georgia. This past year, she returned to the Boston area to work as a family educator in a local conservative synagogue. Molly, a graduate of Stern College, Yeshiva University, works in Jewish communal relations in New York City. She has worked with Jewish youth both in this country and abroad. Molly brings an Orthodox perspective to the Genesis program. Mike is a graduate of SUNY Buffalo. He worked for 4 years as a youth leader in a local conservative synagogue. This year, Mike will begin his rabbinical studies at the University of Judaism in Los Angeles. Zoe grew up as an unaffiliated Jew on the West Coast. She worked there in film and video production. She decided to spend 2 years studying traditional Judaism and Jewish education in Jerusalem. She brings to Genesis the perspective of one who is new to her traditional Jewish practice.
The training program at Genesis has been designed, we hope, to really serve as paradigm for how the CIEs then will work with the students in transferring values, ideas, and structure to their Genesis experience. For example, each day of our one-week training program with the CIEs focuses on a different theme or issue that relates to the role of the CIE and their role in turn with the student. One day of our one-week training is around the theme of Shabbat. Before the CIEs even come to the program, they have been given assignments to look and experience different types of Shabbat experiences in their lives, and then be able to transfer that into how then could we possibly create a more diverse notion of Shabbat within the Genesis experience. For many of the CIEs, and for many of all of us, Genesis is the first experience that is a truly pluralistic Jewish experience for Shabbat. The philosophy behind Genesis, and this is one of the things that we do within our training, is to look and see, even within the diversity of the CIEs, there is such a breadth of Jewish traditions and experiences and hopes of their own Shabbat experiences that we will try and figure out among ourselves what would be a good Shabbat for ourselves first, before then figuring out how then that experience may be transferable to the students.
At least the principle, now we talk about what a typical Shabbat at Genesis could or would look like, it's then really looking about, okay, so do we really want to push that ourselves?
We busted our butts for, you know, the whole week to get it done, but yet they feel like they did it.
So the informal educators themselves will work as a unit to both represent diverse opinions, perspectives, and beliefs, and also to work together to really engage every single student in one way, shape, or form throughout the program.
We, as a group of CIEs, made Havdalah together, and somewhere, at the point where we guess we start reciting the brachot, a few people started singing, lai, lai, la, 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 la.
I felt bad for the person who was leading, and I also felt bad because I felt like I didn't get the Havdalah that I need.
And there was also the issue that I, in particular, had been asked to lead Havdalah, and so I was going to do it the way I do it, and had prepared myself to do it that way. And everybody who likes to sing just jumped right in and basically took it over right through the end of Havdalah. And so that also just felt uncomfortable, and so someone disrespected whatever.
So I had originally said that either the Orthodox kids are going to feel uncomfortable. So I said either we should be doing Havdalah separately in Ma'ariv, and then after that we can go and meet up with everybody else and do the Havdalah service.
The essence of Havdalah are there three blessings in the middle. The blessing on the candle, on the spices, and on the wine. And it's very important that the person who is reciting Havdalah recite each of these blessings clearly, and those who are listening have the opportunity to say Amen. By the Debbie Friedman tune, everybody sings the blessings together, and there's no space in the music for answering Amen. It's a subtle difference, but to an Orthodox person, an important difference. Culturally, the Orthodox are accustomed to a short, brief, and to the point Havdalah.
The issues that came up for us as a small group of CIEs coming from very different backgrounds religiously manifested completely with the students.
I think the ideal at Genesis is to be a reflective practitioner. Part of being a reflective practitioner is to reflect on the hard pieces, both of what you're experiencing and what the group of CIEs is experiencing.
In fact, it's far more difficult for CIEs just themselves to have a meaningful Shabbat in their week of training than it is for them to be able to transfer their love of Shabbat and the options available for students to own Shabbat as the program itself evolves and as the students arrive.
Of course, you know, the kids arrive the next morning, and so it all flips on them by the next morning when the kids arrive.
And my theory is processing is always great. The trick is balancing processing with the considerable time demands of running everything else in the program. It is self-indulgent, it feels, when there's so much else to do. But certainly, any chance to sit around and review our actions and the way we work together is a bonus. Because certainly there are issues that stay hidden until we have a chance to sit down and deliberately approach them, and I think it's only a good thing when we do.
I just didn't want it to be what we did last week. Yeah, to be totally honest, I knew it was going to be great because it was not going to be the seven of us like sitting around and staring at each other trying to like hyperanalyze what was going on.
Right.
And that's exactly what happened. You know, like all the focus shifted onto the kids, thank God, as it should. And whatever, you know, like all of a sudden, like we could kind of like displace our personal tensions onto the kids. So it was, you know, if it's not totally healthy, then at least it made it easier to deal with each other.
The first Shabbat with the students, I was a little bit anxious because I wanted to make sure that everyone felt comfortable. And I was concerned that there are a lot of students coming from many different backgrounds, and knowing my situation and how I felt when I came into situations where it was a big, diverse crowd, I was concerned that specifically the Orthodox kids, I was concerned that they not feel like it was too pluralistic, that they were asked to give up too much. And at the same time that the kids who were unaffiliated wouldn't feel that everything is being run to the extreme so that they are being made to do things that they would never want to do.
I know that if someone was saying this, as you heard in our group meeting, that we have to accommodate the more religious people, I felt like, you know, what about me if I'm not comfortable with that? Why don't we have to accommodate me?
Abdullah was a little bit awkward. I didn't have a problem with Abdullah. I didn't think it was what the kids wanted.
Well, I noticed that here, a lot of people seem to enjoy specifically Abdullah. You know, in my shul, we just say Abdullah, and then we go home. Here, I've noticed, you know, it's a very good thing. Everybody likes to sing, and I think it was very interesting to me.
I love praying. I love singing when praying, and prayer is really important for me.
Yeah, well, I mean, Havdalah is a service which I feel is very spiritual and personally meaningful.
Everybody had been saying all week when we were talking about Shabbat how they love Havdalah, and Havdalah is this wonderful, beautiful time for singing Jewish and non-Jewish songs, and you know, the la-la-las and the works. They wanted that.
So we talked about it a lot and didn't really have an answer. So when it came time to do Havdalah and we had, you know, 80 people in a circle, we looked at each other and Scott was going to lead it and said, how are we going to do this? Did we ever make a decision? And I looked at him and I said, no, we didn't.
And I remember like that moment right at the beginning where I was like, we never decided what we were going to do.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And we're like, we'll just start it and we'll see what happens. which was like, you know, maybe like the most non-committal, wishy-washy, non-decision that we could have made in that moment.
That Tuesday morning, the CIEs met to plan what they were going to do about Havdalah. They didn't really resolve the issue, but they did decide that evening they would set up a series of student committees that would deal with different aspects of planning Shabbat.
Okay, we are going to work a little bit on Shabbat for an hour, and then we're going to have a workshop on pluralism within the Jewish world. Okay. There's a lot to say about all of these subjects. In terms of Shabbat committees, first of all, I just want to say that you're all invited to switch committees if you want to, or stick with the committee you're already on. People who are not in any committees, if they went to the discussion groups and don't feel a part of the committees, please join a committee that seems interesting to you. And if people are talking about things that you don't understand, please ask for help so that you will understand. There are people who can certainly explain if you're coming in a little bit late.
There's a Havdalah committee, there's a Kabbalat Shabbat committee, and there's a Zmirot or Song committee.
Any ritual?
Overall general ritual.
Oh, and that also falls under the auspices umbrella of ritual. So if you're interested in doing any of those,
everybody, we're going to go around the circle, and everyone's going to say something they liked or didn't like about last week.
Let's try to keep it brief, so, like...
Yeah. And if somebody already said your comments, just don't say it.
All right, let's start with Laura.
I liked being with my friends with Dylan and Dahlia.
Let's just bounce around. I don't think we need to go right in the way.
Okay, I didn't think it was close enough. I thought being in the big circle felt really far away from everybody.
So you like the spiral?
So the spiral would be good.
With the far away, you couldn't hear what was going on.
Yeah, also, it was kind of boring. I liked the tune.
Yeah.
There were no tune, no singing.
And they didn't use the traditional tune.
Yeah, they didn't really use it.
The first week, the service was not, you know, the traditional la-la-la-la-la-la-la, yeah, that wasn't done. And so there were people that sort of missed the, I mean, I think a lot of Havdalah is sort of the, you know, the spiritual aspect, the kavanah that you get from, you know, singing the tune and, you know, the swaying and stuff like that. So that was definitely something that people were missing in the first one, and we tried to inject back into it in the second one.
This guy Sam is someone that I'm really keying into, and I think he's got a lot to give the community. He's very like extroverted, he's knowledgeable, like he's charismatic, and he cares.
Yeah, he has a really cool way. Sam has something to say.
Are we going to organize the singing
like
after
guy?
The
I think they are.
Is there going to be any organized singing after the fast jubilato?
You know what, we gotta, Sam, we gotta, like, people complain that we have to make the singing optional because people complain.
Right, so let's make the singing optional.
I'm always, that's not our decision. I stayed every time.
So do you want to say, like,
this goes over to the singing committee, though, doesn't it?
Yeah, I don't know. If you want to sing, then you can stay here. If you want to go to blah, 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 you can do that.
And we'll have Simon play the guitar because no matter
what people want to hear.
Exactly, he'll know it.
If you start it, I will remember it. I can't remember how it starts.
Now Yeshua Tzimi, F. Prag, Giyazi Vizi Makah, Shemai Yeshua, Ushah.
I was sitting there and watching. We've added to doubt a lot of moments where the very meeting we're looking at seemed to spiral out of control. They couldn't each sit with one of these subgroups. And they came up with the idea that they would be present and would stand in the middle of the room and circulate and lend an ear, and if necessary, lend a hand, but essentially allow each subcommittee to do its own work. What amazed me in sitting and observing the ritual committee at work was how once the CIEs step back and allow the students to gain control, how several student leaders emerged with such strength and charm. Of course, central to that is Sam, who in effect was running that meeting.
Havdalah is really the only service, the only service, we do Birkat all together, but I would say the only service that we do, you know, with all the denominations. So, you know, you have an issue. I had never done this paragraph before the four brachot, the Hine El Yeshuati paragraph. So right there was an issue, you know, we had to incorporate that.
We have 5 more minutes left. I just wanted to recap. Can we just recap what we talked about? So
we're going to have to meet again.
Yeah, oh, definitely. But like, we have the thing where we're going to go around the spiral, whatever it is, and say one word that separates Shabbat.
Guys, can I listen to Dave for a second?
Yeah. Okay. Just like a recap of what we discussed. We had the one word thing around the spiral. Well, first of all, forming in a spiral so everyone can see. Holding the candle, the wine, whatever, up high so everyone can see. Going around and saying one word that separates Shabbat from the rest of the week. Exactly.
Dave, sitting there in the yellow shirt, is the young man who not only often makes key points, but also who at one point summarizes all the points they made throughout the meeting with great skill. And then there's Avi, who in a sense says, shh, everybody, let's listen to Dave. And then there's Sharon, who makes a lot of key points, who adds a lot of spirit to the meeting, and who helps keep the meeting going. And then there's Deborah, who was actually at another meeting, is called over. And she, with incredible skill, helps to teach the whole group how to sing this Havdalah, opening paragraph, blessings, closing paragraph, according to Debbie Friedman tune. And then there's the girl who has the courage to say, what about transliteration? After all, many of the people in this group know Hebrew. And here's one girl who doesn't know Hebrew and who's willing to admit it and call for the kind of steps that need to be made so that non-Hebrew readers can follow the Havdalah. And indeed, they follow her advice.
But I think the big thing here is the matter of giving the space and also really acknowledging that they're young adults. And not just they're away from home and figuring out boundaries, but they're figuring out things for themselves. So much of what these students have Jewishly is what is fed to them by their parents and by their congregations and by whatever else they're involved, whatever their other involvements are. And here's a chance for them to make their own definition. And I think it's our biggest task is to really encourage them to find their own bit there.
By the last Shabbos, we're going to be running everything. I think that's true. And I think that'll be really amazing. Yeah. Because it'll be everyone from different backgrounds working together. So I think it'll basically cater to everyone's needs.
It's important to realize that the CIEs created a certain atmosphere. And so what we're going to do is talk about that. So they had interceded earlier. They had interceded earlier by, in a sense, making certain things possible at Genesis that often aren't possible in other settings. By that I mean, what we talked about earlier, that the CIEs, in a sense, said to these students, you can do this. They also weren't absent. When the CIEs restrained themselves, they didn't step out of the picture, they stepped to the back of the picture.
Our aim by the end of the 4 weeks is for the students to feel and to be fully empowered and owners of the Shabbat experience or of other learning and living experiences here at Genesis. By the fourth week, the role therefore of the CIEs is much less hands-on, is much more facilitative behind the scenes and providing resource to the students who are in the driving seat.
Sam told us that he felt empowered by Scott. What does that mean? He felt that right from the beginning that Scott was able to, in a sense, identify Sam's strength and give support to Sam's strength in the Reform context, but beyond the Reform context. So Sam felt enabled by Scott's confidence in him.
Wait, I have a better idea.
How does an adult, without intervening, offer a younger person the adult sense of confidence? I think you can do this.
Now we need to get people on the line. Where's Deborah? Show them up the screen. Wait, do we have matches? Do we have matches? We gotta be ready to go. We gotta be ready to go.
Teens are wanting to own their own identity. They're wanting to own their own community. They're wanting to own their own culture, their own history, their own rituals, and their own traditions. And so much of the notion of empowerment within Jewish education, and particularly at Genesis, is around the idea that you can take a piece of this Shabbat, a piece of this Havdalah, a piece of this Jewish life, and know enough about it to own it and to take it with you when you go back home, so that you live and can live a more meaningful Jewish experience back home based on some experiences and some skills and some perhaps jumping off points that you have learned at Genesis.
You'll see when you watch, if you look carefully, you'll see in the video of the last Havdalah that Sam and Deborah and Sharon are standing in the middle of the circle and in effect leading the singing of the Havdalah prayer. I think it's very significant that at the end of the summer when we interview the CIEs, they say with great pride, yes, Havdalah was the part of Shabbat that the kids most truly owned on their own. Whether or not they intended Havdalah to be that part, or whether they walked away from a dilemma that they themselves couldn't solve, they had the maturity, once the students took steps towards owning it, to be totally supportive of student ownership of Havdalah.